stand up real quick, high five somebody, and here's what I want you to do. I know you've already talked. I know you already said this, that, or the other. I want you to find someone you have not said hi to and may not even know their name, all right? Move around. High five them. I love that. I love fellowship. I love encouragement. Okay, would you take your seat? And as you do, I want to invite Pastor Aaron, Kaylee, Ben, Katie, come on up here real quick. I want to celebrate some of our pastors. This is, in case you didn't know, this is Pastor Appreciation Month. And my wife wanted to be here as well for this, but she's serving at another campus. And as you know, Ben in Creative Arts and Aaron kicking it in our Y&B and our student ministry are just fantastic leaders, excellent leadership. Also, I want to celebrate Pastor Randy at our Little Flock campus and Pastor Kevin at our Quitman, Texas campus. And would you do this for me? Would you honor all of these with a round of applause real quickly? I love that. Yes, I love that. And you'll be receiving from your leaders a $100 gift card for these guys, because there's not a Ruth Chris within a few yards of where you're at. And then also blessing the rest of the staff with Ruth Chris Steakhouse gift cards. And it's just such a blessing. These guys do an unbelievable job. And I love the heart and passion of all of them. And I'm so thankful. So thankful for what's going on in their lives and how they're such a blessing to me. Thank you guys so much. Appreciate you so much. Love you guys. I love it. Be blessed. You sure you don't want to preach, Aaron? You're okay? I got it. All right. If you have a copy of God's Word, turn to the book of Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and Ephesians chapter 4. And I know everybody's using mobile devices, all that. I'm just old and I say open your Bible. So you're still kind of opening it, right? Even though not necessarily in the way that we did back in the old days. But we are in the concluding week of the series, Haunted House, being truly inhabited by the Holy Ghost. And as we've walked through the process, this is such a deep, this is such a rich series. This is, to be honest with you, it's a little overwhelming. I mean, it really is, to grab hold of, to understand it all, to be obedient in all of it and walking through it and desiring to learn as much as you can. I know it is overwhelming. But what I want you and I to understand by God's grace is this is not informational preaching. This is transformational preaching. This is not, hey, that's a cool Bible study thought. This is, my life is getting ready to forever change, and everyone that comes in contact with me is going to get a little bit of the transformation truth of the Holy Ghost residing in fullness in my life. Matter of fact, the Holy Ghost was so empowered, living fully in the life of Peter, that the scripture indicates in Acts, in the book of Acts chapter 19, that when he walked past sick people, just his shadow would heal them. Now you say, well, that's the book of Acts. I believe this with all my heart, church. I believe it with all my heart. Those things, God is ready through the power of the Holy Ghost for those things to take place right now today. If you believe he's still that powerful, say amen. Amen. Why are we not trusting the Holy Ghost with all of his power within us, where we see a touch and we see healing, where we see a smile and it brings about a new anointing? The truth is this: God wants us to fulfill all that he's called us to do. The scripture says this. I was reading in my personal worship in Matthew chapter 6 and verse number 19. It says, don't store up for yourselves treasure here on earth where moths and rust can destroy. If you kind of remember that verse, or you kind of think you've heard that before at all of our campuses, raise your hand. Okay, you kind of heard something like that. Well, it goes on to say this. Instead, what does it say? store up for yourselves. I'm just pausing right there. Treasure. Store up for yourselves. What God is telling us is this. There is a need for transaction once you get to heaven. So you better be storing up all you can when you get. Listen, Jesus, you're not storing up rewards because he needs it. I think he's got plenty. He wants you to store it up. How can we store up the fullness of reward at a greater level? Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Surrender to all that God is calling you to be. I don't want my life to be explainable without the Holy Ghost. I don't want my life to be explained. I want there to be such a demand and a necessity that only will it happen if the Holy Ghost sees it through. And that's what God's calling us to. I look at the work and the ministry of Brand New Church. The only way this thing has miraculously been given favor by God is through the power of the Holy Ghost and only because of him. And it is undeniable in this ministry, in many places in our lives. And I want us as a church to take this week number four, which I'm calling the supernatural church. We talked about our house, the temple. We talked about our physical house, 11103 Bear Drive, our physical house being filled with the Holy Ghost. I want to talk about his house, the local body. The church is not four walls, we know that, but there is a representation all through Scripture and his passion for the local church. It's an institution that Jesus created. Matthew chapter 16 and verse number 18. Says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. This is God's plan. This is God's will. This is God's direction. And I know that you and I are desirous of being effective in this mission, not an audience, but an army. How does that transpire? Number one is this, you've got to be saved. If you don't know Christ, you cannot be filled with the Holy Ghost. If you don't know Jesus, you're not going to operate in the understanding that the Spirit of God is leading, guiding, and directing you in everything. Do I think he's going to pick and choose for you whether you should have Cocoa Pebbles or Fruity Pebbles? No, I don't think he's working in that necessarily that specific. I think your waist should tell you whether or not you should eat those. But I do know this. He is going to give you and lead and guide in the specifics of being effective in ministry and especially in building his church. Once you receive the Spirit of God, Acts chapter 2, verse 38, they're asking the question, how can we be saved? How can we truly know Christ? In verse number 38, it says this, repent. The word repentance means do a 180. It truly means this. Here's what it means. It means you must have a change of mind. The old is gone and the brand new has come. Brand new church. The old is gone. The brand new has come. You being saved is a evidence by having a changed mind. God does all the saving, but we have to do our part too. And that is yield ourselves, receive and confess, and in doing so, that is our change of mind through the power of the Holy Ghost. If your mind's not been changed, you can't be a part of advancing the supernatural church. There has to be a change of mind. Repent. And then it says this, be baptized. If you've been saved and you have never been scripturally baptized, which is by immersion, you need to be baptized. Baptism doesn't save you, but it is telling everyone, I had a change of mind. I'm going to live for Jesus. The jersey is on. The wedding ring, if you will, is on. And I'm ready to live fully committed to Jesus Christ. And then it says this, be filled with the Holy Ghost. It doesn't mean you don't receive all of the Holy Ghost. It means this, I am yielding myself to the complete work of the Holy Ghost in my life. With my mouth, with where I go, with what I do. Specific though today is advancing the work of the church. God, through the power of the Holy Ghost, through the power of the Holy Spirit, has given you a gift. He's giving you not just a gift. I'm going to read to you all the gifts here in just a second. He's giving you the ability, because the Spirit of God, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I'll read it to you in just a second. The Spirit of God has given the gifts of His Spirit to all of us. So if all of His Spirit lives in us, then we are able to operate by the fullness of the Holy Ghost. You don't just receive one gift or a primary gift. We've been taught that for years. Will you operate in a primary gift? Oftentimes, without a doubt. There's no doubt about it. But if all of the Spirit of God lives in you, then all of the gifts of God are available to you. If you believe that, say amen. Listen, don't back down. Don't just say, well, I've got the spirit of an apostolic gift or a word of knowledge, or I've got wisdom. And then you're going to simply say, well, because of that, I'm going to be rude, or I'm going to not be an evangelist, or I'm not going to. God has given you an unbelievable surrender to the Holy Spirit of God to operate in the fullness of His gift. And if you're like, well, my personality doesn't lend myself to have mercy. If the Spirit of God lives in you, you should show mercy. Not only that, the Beatitudes teach that. It should be an attitude. Not only is there gifts, there's fruit. We already know that. Joy, love, peace, patience, goodness, kindness. You know those things. Gentleness. And I don't even want to talk about the last one, self-control. Isn't that amazing that we can excuse the Spirit of God's fruit in our life and be a complete behiney and say it's okay? The fullness of the Holy Ghost. Here's how we receive and know we have and can operate in advancing God's supernatural church. Who wants to be a part of a supernatural church? Raise your hand at all of our campuses. I don't want to play church. I want to be a part of a supernatural church, where we see healings and life change and salvation on a regular basis, and marriages saved, and rebellious teens set free, and people finding their gift and changing their business and their school and their ball team and operating therein. How do you find that gift? Let me tell you how you don't. You don't by willpower. You cannot in your willpower operate in the fullness of the gift God's called you to. And who has the gift? If you're saved, all of you. Matter of fact, just if you don't mind, just point at yourself. I have a gift. Matter of fact, tell the person next to you, I like your gift. Just high five. If you don't know them, that may be weird, but just high five and say, I like your gift. You have a gift. You cannot find it by willpower. You can find it by the Word of God. I'm going to read you all of the gifts. We're going to do it quickly, but I'm going to give you the text so you can study it on your own. Number two, it's willpower. It's the Word that gives a gift, but you cannot find and operate the supernatural church and the gift God's called you to by force. You just can't force it. You have to be forcefully led by the Holy Ghost. It's not just going to happen by force. Well, I want this, or I want that, or I want this. Scripture says this in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 4. God conformed the message by, look at this, confirmed the message by giving signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit whenever He chose. Listen, people need to be a part of a work corporately where we cannot explain any other way than biblically what God is doing. I sat and was meeting with one of our advisors this morning, and I sit back and look at what God is doing at Brand New Church. Only God can do what is happening at Brand New Church right now. Only God can give us a virtually free building in Russia. Only God can allow us to see, listen to this, 57 baptisms and 11 Sundays. Only God can do this. Only God can bring about the resources. Only God can give us, and I just did a quick math, almost 200 square feet just between three campuses to see lives change. Only God can do that. But here's the thing. We haven't even scratched the surface, because many of you aren't doing jack squat in your gifting for God. I'm not mad at you. I'm just saying, get ready to open the gift. Who likes gifts? Raise your hand. Get ready to open your gift. Open it up and say, I can't wait to use it. I'm ready. I want to be a participant. You're not called to sit here and say, that was a nice message. By the way, you can say that. But that's not your gift. Your gift is to participate in this message and to inspire someone else. And people go, that's supernatural. I don't even know who you are. That's God. And your shadow walks past people, and sickness is gone, and lack is gone, and an understanding of God's word comes alive because they see it in you. And we don't do stuff because we like it or we understand it. It is truly done by God. 1 Corinthians 12:7. Here's the deal. If you're a Christ follower, you got to repent, be baptized, submit yourself to the Holy Ghost. So we've clarified that. And if in doing so, here's what 1 Corinthians 12 says. Each person is given something to do. In the Greek, each person means this. It means each person. Everybody has something to do. Why? Because I gave you something. I gave you something. How many times do I need to take a sorry gift and wear it so you know I wore it? You know what I'm saying? You get that tie for pastor appreciation, which, by the way, don't give me a tie. I'm not saying you can't give me. Give me something, but I might wear a tie, but I don't want to wear a tie. Just how many times you got to actually wear something to make someone think you appreciate it anyway? I don't know. Well, if God gives you a gift, you better wear it. And appreciate it. You know why? Because he bled and died so you could be a part of advancing his kingdom. Amen. What's your gift? What's your gift? I love Christmas time because my kids are wearing their gifts. I love seeing them go out. I mean, I'm telling you, they just got a pair of jeans and they were eating at my family's. They got the jeans on. They're like, yeah, I got these for Christmas. Do you get that for Christmas? Why are you even asking? They're brand new and clean. They're KJs. You know that was a gift. Recent gift. Why aren't you wearing the gift God gave you? You've been given a gift. Look at this. Something to do. Something to do that shows who God is. Who God is. Look at this. Everyone gets in on it. Everyone benefits from your gift. Because you use your gift, I'm blessed by your gift. When you operate in your gift, it blesses me. When you operate in your gift, it blesses others. Others bless you. I want to be blessed by people's gifts. I love seeing people operate in their gifts. I exhort you to operate in your gift. You have to say yes to this. Who gets a gift? I want to say this, point number three, and that is everyone gets a gift. Everyone has a job. Everyone has a duty. It's a blessing from God. If others don't use their gift, you get cheated. But if you don't use your gifts, they get cheated. What's your gift? Now, in your notes, write these things down because we're not going to have time to really dissect all these gifts. They're going to be very explainable. I'm going to take about eight of them to dissect, but we're going to give you what all these gifts are. In Romans chapter 12, verses 6 through 8, note takers, write this down. This will be in your personal journal. You can study these on your own. Here are the gifts that are available to you. Prophecy, ministry, teaching, exhortation, giving, ruling or leadership, and showing mercy. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You can always remember if you get the 12s, you're going to get pretty close. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 29 through 30 is apostles, prophecy, teaching, miracles, healing, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Now I want to stop right there for all of us that are extra Baptist. Okay? And I know that many people have taught, well, tongues is a dead gift. It's not used. It was used for that moment only. I want to tell you in the scripture, it does not teach that any of these gifts are dead because the Holy Spirit's not dead. Do you have to operate in the fullness of all these gifts? I don't believe so, but I do believe this. You should be willing to operate in the fullness of all these gifts. The reason people are like, well, if we believe in tongues, why aren't you here? Listen, tongues are a private prayer language. You do this in private. If you start doing it in public, you have to have an interpreter. And in doing so, even in that, Paul says, don't do this and mess up the funk and junk and confuse people by doing this in public. Do it in private where you can communicate to God, and that's where faith comes in. So I just wanted to touch on that to make sure you understand that I do not believe miracles and the gift of miracles is a past gone, past tense event, because I've watched God heal my family. I've watched miracles take place in this supernatural church, and I want to see more miracles take place. Let your faith believe in the fullness of the Word of God. The reason we want to discount stuff we don't understand is because your fact checks and your own fact understanding diminishes faith in your life and you feel better about it. And I would just encourage you to ask God to operate in all of these gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 10. word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discernment or discerning of spirits, and then again, tongues and interpretation of tongues. Ephesians chapter 4 gives you four gifts to the church. They're not gifts to the totality of the church. They're gifts to the church, which is pastor, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor slash teacher. Those are gifts to the church. Those are gifts to the church. And some of you have the gift of teaching, which is a gift to the church, and you need to be using it. Some of you are using it and you don't have the gift, but you can grow in it. You have a word you want to share. Believe God for these supernatural gifts. Every gift is available. Now, let me just dissect for you Romans chapter 12, these gifts that I believe you just need to be begging God for. Here's the simplicity of them. I'm going to read them to you out of the Message. Here's the Message. It says it this way. If you preach, look at this, just preach God's message, nothing else. I love this. If you help, have the gifts of help or service, just help. Don't take over. This is taking the color of the language and expounding on it in a beautiful paraphrase from Eugene Peterson. If you give encouraging guidance, be careful that you don't get bossy. I love this. If you're put in charge, don't manipulate. If you're called to give and aid, keep your eyes open and be quick to respond. If you work with the disadvantaged, don't let yourself get irritated with them or depressed by them. And I love this last part of it. Keep a smile on your face. Let me ask you a quick question. What's your gift? And are you abiding in your gift to advance God's church? God's given you a local body to advance His kingdom in and through. You've been given a gift. I believe you've been given a taste of all of the gifts because you've been given all of the Holy Spirit. You will abide in, especially as you're educated in what I would call fourth grade math before you get into some serious calculus spiritually. For some of you, fourth grade math is mercy, but for me, mercy is calculus. You know what I'm saying? I have to grow in my measure of understanding and yielding myself to the power of the Holy Spirit. For some of you, fourth grade math is encouraging and calculus for you is giving. You have to grow in that and then operate in the fullness therein. Then guess what? The church is advanced. The purpose of the pastor is not to do the work of the church. The purpose of the pastor is to preach the word of God, where the church does the work to advance the kingdom of God. Imagine hundreds abiding in the power of the Holy Spirit, living out their gifting to change the world. Imagine what would happen. The enemy is so clever to make people love church instead of love being the church. You have discerning, you have declaring, you have dynamic gifts. Are you going to abide in them? Are you going to surrender to them? Notice I didn't say anything about volunteering. That's going to come natural through the supernatural obedience to the Holy Ghost. That's just natural. I mean, you're just going to be like, yeah, oh yeah, of course. But when it comes to knowing a need and meeting a need and encouraging someone who's down or giving a word of knowledge to somebody, you know, I need to speak this to them, or making sure you give them a word of wisdom as the scripture tells us, I believe God is calling you to do so. Recognizing these gifts, fourthly, that every gift lines up with the word of God and every opportunity to participate in it lines up with the word of God. It has to line up with the word of God. You can't say, I got a word of knowledge for you, and that is divorce your husband. That is not God's will. That is not God's will. Now, inevitably, that may take place, but if you're giving a word of knowledge, what you're saying is this: you can do this. You can make this. Here's what God's word says. All things are possible. We're going to move and operate in the word of God. If you're with me still, say yeah. Yeah. Okay, what are you going to do about the gift? Are you going to open it or not? And some of you need to come to your campus pastor and say, I've got the gift of teaching. I know it's in me and I want to utilize that. We're going to find a place for you to do that. And the best way is to start a United. Just start a United yourself, and then we, of course, will give you a thumbs up or thumbs down on what you're desiring to teach, and then we're going to move forward and watch God bless in such a supernatural way. That's why we see our men's and ladies' Bible studies jam-packed on midweeks and the nights they choose to meet, and coffee lovers, because people have the gift, and they're using the gift. They're using the gift. I believe God has given me an apostolic gift to speak truth that lines up with the Word of God. God's not adding anything to His Word, but He's utilizing His church to apostolically speak to you. And there's times where I need to speak to you apostolically and say, it's time for you to start serving. Some of you are sitting on your duff. You're not doing jack. You say, where do I start? Volunteering is a great place to start, to surrender yourself and say no to yourself and say yes to someone else. That's a great way. That's the gift of helps. That's serving. Well, I've got to make it easier. I've got to make it, you know, more about, well, it just didn't work out in this set. Listen, Jesus carried a cross. You can get up 5 minutes earlier and serve. And it's worth it, is it not? It was so worth it just to walk into the doors of the campus I'm teaching in right now and see smiling volunteers before ready time or when normal people get here, and they're ready, smiling, and saying good morning. That changes the whole demeanor of someone who's hopeless and needs hope. And just through your spirit of mercy and a smile and encouragement could change their life so they could come to know Jesus as the boss and rescuer of their life. Amen. Operate in the gift. What's your gift? Ministry, teaching, prophecy, words of wisdom, words of knowledge. Is it healing, tongues, miracles, encouragement, giving, leadership? You have all of them inside of you, but I believe you need to be exercising one of them. For some of you, it's mercy. Operate therein. For my wife, it is hospitality and help. She has that gift. Literally, out of 7 nights this last week, 4 of them, she was cooking for someone else other than herself. Our neighbor's 9-year-old son just lost his foot to cancer. She's the first one over there with a meal. And it just motivated. Ironically, another lady at our Farmington, that one did not attend our church, he was just our neighbor, but a lady in our Farmington campus had foot surgery. She was the first one over there. Took afternoon pumpkin muffins for the afternoon snack and then showed up that evening with homemade chicken pot pie. And if you've ever had Cindy's chicken pot pie, it's God's will. I'm not saying 3 pieces was God's will, but I will exercise today at 1:30-ish, somewhere around there. Are you going to open the gift? You're like, where do I start? Just start somewhere. Start with mercy. Maybe for you, in closing, start with by just getting saved. Repenting. You can't use the power of the Holy Ghost until you plug in. And that's through repentance. And surrender and just say, Lord Jesus, I'm changing my mind right now and I'm making you boss, I'm making you rescuer. I want to serve you. I want to live for you. I don't want to play church. Listen, store up for yourselves treasure in heaven. There's going to be crowns we get at Jesus' feet. But God told you to store up for yourself. I think there's going to be transaction financially take place. Why else would God say that some are going to rule over much and some are going to rule over little in heaven? I'm just saying, can you imagine getting up there and he goes, I gave you all those gifts. Why didn't you open them? I've said it before, I'll say it again. I cannot imagine my wife purchasing me a gift, wrapping it up, laying it on my pillow, and I never unwrap it. And I just want to encourage you in a radical step of faith, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, to surrender to the gift God's given you, which is the gift of His Holy Spirit, and say, I am now ready, Lord Jesus, Holy Ghost, inhabit me, haunt me, with remembrance until I utilize the gift you've given me. My sacrificial gift is simply in obeying and utilizing the gift you've given me. So why? I can be a part of in advance and see the supernatural church thrive. Encouragement, leadership, service, hospitality. Encouragement is so important. And if you would simply say, I am by God's grace yielding myself to the fullness of the Holy Ghost, a true haunting, complete inhabiting of the Holy Ghost, and I am going to say yes to the gifts that he's given to me. Would you just raise your hand at all of our campuses? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Listen, I would just say this. If you are not currently in just a simple mode of service to your local church, you need to see your campus pastor. You need to text, Facebook, your campus pastor. And I'm not talking about later. I'm talking about right now. Immediately. Grab that Facebook. Just shoot him a Facebook message. Phone, say, I'm ready to serve. Put me somewhere. You're like, well, I want to like where I... Listen, you'll like it because you're doing it for Jesus. Just start somewhere. Change a diaper. I sat and walked by and watched one of our advisors rocking a baby just a few minutes ago. Ultimately, the gift is administration. But he's like, I'm going to use the fullness of my gift to show mercy and encouragement to a mom who just needs to hear a message right now. Use the fullness of the Holy Ghost. Surrender to the inhabitants. Let him take over the house. Because when he does, guess what? He's going to take over this house, every one of our campuses, in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for this moment. We surrender to you. God, I cannot wait to see the supernatural church lived out within the walls. You've given us a brand new church in all of our campuses and outside of the walls. In Jesus' holy name. And would you do this? Can we celebrate obedience with applause right now? It's time to serve. It's time to serve. I know what many of you are saying is our host assist us with this moment, which, by the way, is a great place to serve. It's a great place to serve. You know what many are saying? Well, I can serve outside of these walls. And listen, God has given you the gifts to advance his church, and it begins in the storehouse locally. That's where it begins. According to the word of God, he would not have all these letters to churches. Matter of fact, take Revelation chapter 3 and verse number 20. It says, I stand at the door and knock. If any man lets me in, you know who he's speaking to there? He's speaking to the church. Seven of them. Yes, lost people are moved by that text, but the reality is he's speaking to the church and he's knocking, saying, let me in. Let me have over this room, because then you're going to empower the church through encouragement. Some of you have such the gift of encouragement. Utilize the gift of service. Utilize the gifts of helps. I can promise you this, people that are doing CP and opener communication and I think of Jamie G, I think of Heather Hunter, outside of what you'd normally think, that, well, I'm just going to serve any way I possibly can. I'll grab a mic. I'll teach a class. Why? Because the fullness of the Holy Ghost allows us to do that. Some of you have the gift of giving. As our host have passed out an envelope, I encourage you to prepare to give. But as a church member, we're all called to participate in the tithe. Bring the tithe. I will say this just for acknowledgement to the church. October is about $8,800 behind on its receipts for the month. The year is great. We've had a great year. We've been blessed. But I do want to mention that just to give you awareness. Be obedient in the tithe. And then if you're a giver, you're thinking of ways I can give over and above, and you're going to find out cool ways that you can do that with Mercy Meals and so forth and so on at all of our campuses. I encourage you to participate faithfully. Utilize the gifts. Utilize the gifts. Why? Because I want to get to heaven and know I didn't waste my time down here and in any way shame the gift. I just got to tell this story. I'll never forget. I went to camp as a fourth grader, first time I ever went to camp. Matter of fact, I got my shoes stolen this same summer. I only had one pair of shoes. I mean, what parent sends their kids to camp with one pair of shoes and owns a clothing store? I have no idea. I'm not bitter. And I remember losing my shoes. I had to borrow somebody else's size 13. I wore a 6. Either way, it was a unique week. But I remember playing in this ping pong tournament. And as I played, I remember I was just jacking around this, that, the other. And we got to the end of the week, and they like told people's names from the stage who won. And they got these little I don't know if they're trophies or ribbons or t-shirts. I can't really remember what they were. But I remember they got a reward. I was like, well, I'd have played serious if I knew there was rewards. I don't know if you ever saw The Grinch. Reward? They didn't tell me there was a reward. Wouldn't you hate to get to heaven and know you just jacked around down here and you didn't get a reward that God can't wait to give you? Get filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, Scripture indicates there will be many stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ. The Scripture teaches this. That'll be a shame because they didn't do jack squat here on earth for their king. By God's grace, not me. Not with perfection, but with passion to do whatever it takes. And right now is a great time to bring the tithe. Don't create your own Bible. Don't create your own Bible. Just be obedient. Father, thank you for this moment as we have the opportunity to bring the tithe. Let us do so obediently. In Jesus' holy name I pray. And everybody at every campus said, amen, amen and amen.